Hi, Tech Road here. Thought we'd start up a little bit of a small adventure here, and that's related to enabling 10 gigabit networking on the backbone network. And it'll be a kind of a step-by-step process, so there'll be more than one video related to it, but we'll take it as it comes. But anyway, the center part of the 10 gig network is, of course, you need some kind of a switch. So I've been searching a long time for a true 10 gigabit switch. And I found this Aruba Networks unit. And I've been watching them for quite a long time. They come and go, they're not that common, but not that uncommon either. And there's a lot of lots of people have used these as a backbone for their 10 gig network. So anyway, what do we have here? Well, it's actually can't communicate this over the camera, but this is very heavy. So it's got a lot of electronics and inside it. Whoa. Try not to bang it too much. It's got also fans, so it's active cooling. Power input, options for console, different options for console connections, even a USB. That's a serial USB. And that's the front side, of course, looking at. And then this has 48 1 gigabit power over Ethernet ports. And one of the functions of this switch, which is a bit different from other switches, is that this can directly power standalone access points. So you can use this switch as a station for just simple standalone access points. So you can just you have the switch, you put the access point somewhere, you drag a cable, you plug it in, and then the access point is running. And you can have, of course, more than one access point. And this can work either as a level 2 switch or a level 3 switch. And this basically, if I oversimplify, if you put it in level 2, then it works like any other off-the-shelf switch. So you know, not really more advanced than that. And then if you have layer 3, then you can do all kinds of quite a extensive number of different types of network administration features for traffic and port management and other stuff. And it's got these SFA ports, and the key difference between this switch and other switches is that in many ads, they you know, when they talk about 10 gigabyte, they'll kind of throw it in there, but they don't say what is 10 gigabit. So when you're selecting a switch, you need to really make sure that if you have these ports, then that they can actually handle a 10 gigabit module. And this is actually quite simple, like the type name indicates. It's 4 times 10 gigabit. So this is one of the switches where it's relatively easy to actually understand that it actually has some 4 module places, and they all support 10 gigabits. Yeah. So anyway, so I was thinking what one could do now is that we're going to actually never powered it up. So I was thinking we would take a power cable and see if we get any lights. So see if I bought a functioning unit or a pile of junk. One always runs that risk when one buys used stuff. So let's see what happens. Maybe nothing. Or the lights will go out. Or something in between. Now, I have no idea if this has actually ever been factory reset, but I intend to do a factory reset on it. So let's see what happens. They did say it was tested, at least to some extent, before they sent it. Now that sound is both good and bad. The good thing is that it means that the internal logic for the cooling control at least is working. Oh, that's a nice airflow. It's very hot in here right now. Yeah. I would say around 26 Celsius. So I don't know if this will calm down after a while. Borrow this and see what it says. Do we have any errors? Booting, it says. So it's not done yet. They did say that it takes a little while for this thing to boot up, so it's not like instant on. But it's, I think this has several computers inside it. Booting AOS. So, I'll bring you guys back once it's booted. So, that turned nice and quiet. That's what they were saying. Except that I do think that if one had... there are many on the internet that have changed out these fans. And I think they're probably not in the 100% best state. So one of the options could be to actually change out the fans. But I'll see. I mean, this is a reasonable noise. Anyway, so let's see here. What do we have? It's a bit slidey on the table, since. I wonder if I can see it and film it at the same time. Status. Let's see if I can come over here. Maintenance. They're only maintenance though. Upload config. Arrays config. Factory default. So that should be it. Menu. So I'm assuming that we should press that one. And then this should take a while. Hope I clicked on the right stuff. Did I do something wrong? got too impatient. I was thinking it wasn't doing anything because the display, the display was fine. This is more what I would expect, that it would reset the settings and then reboot. So I'll bring you back when it's calmed down. So anyway, now it's calmed down again, so it's rebooted, seems to be operational. So now it's basically reset to a level 2 switch, so you could use it just like any other switch. Now what I'm going to do now is I'm going to access the web configuration for this. Try to record it. That in also, so I'm going to connect the network cable to one of these ports. It doesn't matter which port, just any of these ports, and then to my computer, and then going to try and access the web admin interface to set the username password, and then I want to configure all of these to be 10 gigabit connections. Because now what happens is the default configuration, based on the information I got from reading stuff on the internet, is that two of these ports goes automatically into stack mode. So you can't use them yourself as 10 gigabit ports. You need to actually configure. So let's have I'll get that connected and let's have a look. So anyway, now I connect the network cable into the switch to the computer. I'm using Ubuntu, not that it really matters, you can use Windows also. And then you need to be able to activate the web interface, you need to go into the menu, and under maintenance you go nearly down to the last option where it says GUI quick setup, and then you activate that. And then you have 10 minutes to get DHCP activated on the switch from your computer. So this is the way you do it in Ubuntu. So this, I've done it already. So that basically issues a command to execute the DHCP client and pick up a new IP address, and then you should get an IP address like in the 172.16 range. So let's see if it's alive. So that should be 172.16.0.254 at least. Yeah, according to what I read on the internet. Something like this. There's been a little bit different IP address ranges that have been quoted online, so. So, like 172, 168, I've heard, and or read. But let's see, this one should be that. So, let me go to the browser. Let's see. Work. No, also won't. And these warnings, they're just the browser, because it hasn't got certificates. Old tech. Yep, we accept all the risks. Oh, looks like we're in. That's cool. Let's make the picture a bit bigger. Let's see, zoom. Yeah, I can see it. So let's see, what do we have to change? So we just, here you only, for my use it's a static IP address, so I'll just give it this one here, which is my base router plus one, and then the subnet mask default gateway, and then we leave everything else as is. So let's see what happens if we move on. network. Take a while to plot. I think it might actually reboot, or it will reboot. Because now it's ready to go on the main network, or on our normal network. Like to see it from the interface. Okay, now I think it's rebooting port. Okay, now I need to reconnect things. So I'm going to put this computer back on the my own network, and then I'm going to connect the switch with the cable to the network also. So let's force the Ubuntu box to take a new IP address. Want to update the firmware, which I'm not going to look into right now. It's quite easy to access. You just go here, you just click on maintenance, and then you say image management, and you have an option to upload or upgrade the image level on the machine. So, I don't know. I mean, I have a home lab
so I don't know if it's really that needed to be the latest and greatest. But there, it is possible to access firmware on that. So to configure the extra ports, then we need to install a terminal application, and that's quite easy to do. You can either PuTTY is available on Windows, or you can just install it. Error if you try and start it directly against the server, so I have to go to start it with a PuTTY command, and then you can go in here and change the
Now when
I executed these commands, then I actually got to there. Let's have a look at this again. Yes. the instructions I dug up seem to work, except the fact that it's not showing the interfaces the same way. But this could be, of course, a firmware issue, where I don't have the same firmware as what the people that have been doing this. The difference is that in the examples I've seen online is that when you use the command show interface brief, you actually get, it shows you the stack 1/2 and stack 1/3 interfaces. You have configured and they're yellow. So then they come up in the list. But when I ran the command show interface brief, then you didn't get the stack interface. Except that they're obviously there, since I was able to use the delete command to take them away. So anyway, now I have, theoretically these should be now, they're not connected now, and they can all be used by the user, and they can all be 10 gigs. So, as you see, I've only one port in use right now. No, I think that we pretty much wrapped this thing up. I'm sorry for the background noise, but it's like 35 Celsius, so I need to get the temperature down, otherwise I'm going to get a video done. It's summertime. Anyway, if you thought this was useful, then consider hitting the like button. If you want to see more development on this backbone network, then consider subscribing, and you can buy me a cup of coffee if you like. Links are in the links in the description, and also there's merch available. So anyway, let's take this to the next level. See you in the next one.
So gotta try and swap this one out. I moved it out of here, so this is the little slot that I want. New one to go into. So, and then I just need to get a block for the back, like I had before. So, that's the side there. Perfect. Everything works.
but you know what? We'll let the switch boot up. Oh, now it's gone down. So, let's hope that this will work okay now. That was scary. How does it hit? This is never gonna light up.
Okay.
Don't get lights, then I'm not happy.
Okay, next one seems to be Gigabit. The two status lights, if both sides light up, then it's gone to Gigabit. But I'm gonna double check it. The monitoring software. Cool. So that's the main network going passing through here. Move these down a bit. Breaking up nicely.
This one I'm a bit skeptical about. Seems to be blinking okay. I think it's my main workstation that Nick built into the real technique built into the motherboard. It actually has shown to not like specific power over Ethernet switches. The network won't work. To have. Do we have some lights? Yes.
Do we have blinky blinky. Nice to have blinky blink. These over. So now it's just local network stuff. Machines and stuff. I don't even remember what most of these cables are for anymore.
So, empty and done. Now I'll just use the machines and check that there actually is traffic, or that the actual everything is actually working. So, but according to the blinky lights, then everything should be okay. So anyway, that's pass-through networking tested, so the downstream switches pick up signals and computers work, and the local stuff connected to the switch seems to be working okay. So I'm going to call this a success for now. And, move on with the project.